for over 4 million residential, commercial, and industrial customers. Over half of First Energy's electricity is produced by using coal, compared to about 60% nationwide. Let's see how electricity is generated from coal by taking a virtual tour of a coal-fired power plant, similar to those operated by First Energy. This plant has three generating units that produce more than 2,000 megawatts of electricity at full capacity.
To run a power plant can produce enough electricity to supply the needs of 1.5 million homes and businesses. Generating electricity requires a fuel source. At this plant, the fuel source is coal, which arrives mainly by a barge, but also by rail and truck. Each barge delivers 1,500 tons of coal, enough to keep the plant running for a couple of hours. The plant uses about 21,000 tons of coal each day, so over a million tons of coal is stockpiled next to the plant. A device called a stacker reclaimer scoops coal onto a 4-mile-long conveyor that can transport up to 900 tons of coal into the plant each hour. Once inside the plant, up to a 30-hour supply of coal can be stored in bunkers. Coal moves from the bunkers to feeders to be measured and moved to pulverizers. Each generating unit has 16 coal feeders that supply 8 pulverizers. Coal enters the pulverizer and spins in a large drum, where hundreds of steel balls grind it into a fine powder. Now a fine powder, the coal leaves the pulverizers and heads to the boiler. About 335 tons of coal can be pulverized per hour. Large fans add warm air to the powdery coal and blow it into the boiler. The boiler has miles of tubes filled with high-quality water. Once inside the boiler, the coal ignites, releasing energy and generating intense heat that changes the water inside the tubes to hot, dry steam. The temperature of the steam is now about 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. This process generates thermal energy, which is transformed to mechanical energy at the turbine, which is the next stop on our tour. High-pressure steam, now 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit at 3,500 pounds per square inch, is piped from the boiler to the first in a series of turbines. Here it expands between layers of turbine blades mounted on the turbine shaft. The steam loops back to the furnace, then onto the second turbine. In this process, the steam turns the series of turbines 3,600 revolutions per minute, providing power to the generator, the last in the series of machines. The generator continuously creates an electrical charge of 34,481 amps at 18,000 volts of electricity. From here, the electricity leaves the plant and begins its journey to customers. After the steam has been used to create electricity, it is exhausted from the turbine and sent to a condenser to be changed back into water. Inside the condenser, steam passes over the outside of pipes filled with chilled water from the cooling towers. The steam condenses to water and returns to the boilers to repeat the steam generating process over again. As the steam condenses, the chilled water inside the condenser pipes becomes warm from the heat of the steam, so it is sent to a cooling tower. These particular towers are called natural draft cooling towers, which are designed with no moving parts. Inside, the water splashes over a series of baffles, which breaks up the water into small droplets. These droplets mix with air from the open bottom of the tower, evaporating some of the water and cooling the rest by as much as 27 degrees. The newly chilled water returns to the condenser to repeat the process of cooling more steam. Since 1971, First Energy has spent more than $5 billion on environmental protection. Our plants are equipped with air quality control systems to remove sulfur dioxide and particulates called fly ash. Fly ash is removed by a mechanical process and sulfur dioxide is removed with a chemical reaction using lime. These processes take place in large ductwork scrubber trains located between a unit's boiler and its chimney. Boiler gases pass through scrubbing vessels and are sprayed with slurry, a mixture of water and lime. The sulfur dioxide particles and other pollutants are absorbed by the slurry and fall to the bottom of the vessels. A fan releases the cleansed gases through the chimney. By the time this happens, more than 99% of particulates have been removed, as well as 92% of sulfur dioxide. A plant similar to this one can remove over 400,000 tons of sulfur dioxide each year. The scrubbing process creates huge amounts of a byproduct called calcium sulfite. This plant could create more than 3 million gallons of calcium sulfite slurry each day. First Energy created a process that turns that waste product into a valuable building material called gypsum, which is used to make wallboard or drywall. The slurry leaving the scrubbers is thickened and pumped through a forced oxidation gypsum or fog system. Oxygen is then added, changing it into gypsum, which is dried, treated, and sent to a gypsum manufacturer to make wallboard. First Energy recycles about 500,000 tons of gypsum each year, enough to manufacture wallboard for 70,000 new homes. Precipitators are another method of extracting coal ash, also called fly ash, which can be recycled or deposited in landfills. This mechanical process extracts fly ash left over from the combustion process. These poles, called wrappers, shake fly ash from a vibrating wire. Gas from the furnace containing fly ash flows into the box. The fly ash drops into a storage chamber and is blown into silos to be loaded into a truck. Fly ash from First Energy plants is used in manufacturing a variety of products, including concrete, grouting, roofing shingles, granules, and anti-skid road materials. First Energy also uses selective catalytic reduction technology, or SCR, to reduce nitrogen oxide emissions. SCR systems work much like a catalytic converter on a car. Flue gas containing nitrogen oxide emissions from the combustion process is mixed with ammonia. The mixed gases travel through a series of catalytic layers, which causes the nitrogen oxides to react with the ammonia. The reaction converts the nitrogen oxides to water vapor and pure nitrogen, a benign chemical that makes up 80% of the air we breathe. Both elements are returned to the environment through the station's stacks. Now that we've taken a look at how electricity is produced and some of the environmental control protection systems used at our plants, let's take a look at how the electricity is delivered to our homes and businesses. Transformers located just outside the plant boost the power from 18,000 volts to 345,000 volts. So it can travel long distances over transmission lines to where it is needed. Substations located along the path reduce the voltage so it can be moved along distribution lines attached to utility poles. As the electricity nears customer locations, transformers on poles step down the power for use in homes and businesses. We hope you enjoyed seeing how electricity is produced at First Energy, where our energy is working for you.
Lights on. Okay, so what we watched is a summary of a typical coal-based power station. Although there is a substantial number of differences between what you saw here, which is a typical American power plant, right, to what happens in typical Indian power plants. So let's try to understand the block diagrams first, and then I'll come to a little bit of details. Pen side. So just visualizing a power plant, you have the main steam cycle where you have the four components, the boiler, the condenser, the boiler feed pump, and the turbine. Okay, so this is your thing. So from the boiler, the steam goes to the turbine. From the turbine, the steam goes to the condenser. From the condenser, it is pumped back to the boiler. So this is your whole circuit that happens. So the water is in a closed circuit. Now this water is heated by steam, heated by the furnaces where coal is fired. So there is one subsystem here where coal arrives, supplied to the boiler in a particular way, it is burned, and there is a flue gas that goes out which is disposed of. So another cycle besides this main cycle of your working fluid, you have fuel, air, flue gas system, that's one subsystem. You have the condenser where a large amount of heat is rejected. Okay, so typically in a power plant of coal of this kind, the efficiency is at most 40%. The efficiency values are between 35% and 40%. So about 65% of the energy that is supplied by your furnace has to be finally rejected in the condenser. Okay, so if I talk about a 200 megawatt power plant, okay, so 200 megawatt is only about 40% of the energy that is supplied by the boiler. So the furnace supplies about 500 megawatts of energy to the steam in the boiler. So out of the 500 megawatts, 200 megawatts is given out as electric output. The remaining 300 megawatts are rejected in the condenser. Okay. So the condenser is where actually the energy has to be taken away from steam to convert it from steam to water by a cooling water circuit. So here you have another circuit which has cooling water that takes energy from the steam and condenses the steam, and this energy is thrown back into the atmosphere in a certain mechanism. There are places where you have a large lake or a sea or ocean from where the water is taken, used for cooling, and then let back into the water body. There are places where there is no such abundance of water available, so you need to reuse the same water, so you have cooling towers. So most of the water gets recycled, some part of the water gets evaporated, which has to be replenished on a continuous basis. Okay, typically about 5% to 7% of water that is used in the cooling water circuit, which is a lot of water, actually evaporates, and that much of water needs to be supplied on a continuous basis to keep this circuit running. So you have the main water circuit, you have the fuel, air, flue gas system, and you have the cooling tower operation. Besides this, you have the flue gases that need to be treated, the environmental protection that they talked about, and you have the ash removal system because the combustion leaves behind residual ash. There is a major difference in this part between the system that you saw in the video and what we have in this country. In most parts of the world, the ash content in coal is less than 10%. Okay, say anywhere between 4 to 8, 9% is the ash that they talk about. So if they are burning 100 tons of coal, there will be about 4 or 5 tons or 8 tons of ash that comes out. The Indian context is very different. Our coals have a lot more ash. The typical ash content of Indian coals varies from 30 to 45%. So if I burn 100 tons of coal, from 30 to 45 tons of ash will be produced. And therefore, the calorific value of the coal is also that much lower because there is so much of non-combustible in the coal. And therefore, the coal requirement for unit power output will also be more, right? So in effect, you are actually carrying practically about 40% of the coal that you are transporting in the form of ash from wherever you are bringing it. So a typical power plant like Dadri would require something like 5 to 6 train loads of coal to be supplied from mines in West Bengal and Bihar. Okay, so train loads, about 6 to 7 train loads of coal come every day, each train having about 60 wagons, each wagon carrying about 30-40 tons of coal. Okay, so this is the coal consumption per day. You have about 6 to 7 trains of coal. You can calculate that. We had one of these exercises in our tutorial sheet. So that much of coal that is transported, practically if you are transporting about 7 trains of coal, out of the 7 trains of coal, about 3 trains would be ash and 4 trains would be coal. Unfortunately, cannot be separated before it is burned. Right? So that's the thing that you do. So practically you are transporting half of your material or nearly half of your material as ash. That's our thing. But on the other hand, the ash disposal also becomes a major problem. So every day you are rejecting about 3 train loads of ash. Right? 3 train loads meaning 3 into 60 into 30 tons of coal are going to be thrown out every day. So Dadri actually has a dry disposal system for ash. Most other power plants in the country actually put water into the ash, make it into the form of slurry, and pump it and throw it into places which are not populated. Okay, and there the water from the slurry would leach down into the ground, carrying the heavy metals of whatever is there in the ash. So completely polluting the groundwater. The amount of water required is also substantial. You can understand that. In Dadri, it's a dry disposal system, so there is no not as much water that is utilized. But what is done is it is taken in conveyor belts and thrown in a whole ash mound. The ash mound area is about 350 acres, which is slightly bigger than IIT campus. And over a period of 25 years of the useful life of the plant, which it has already lived, right? The design was that the ash mound will become a 55 meters tall mountain. Okay, so imagine an area of IIT Delhi growing into a 55 meter tall ash mound. So that is the size of mountain that is created there. If we have the time when we go for the visit, we'll also go to the ash mound. What they are trying to do is to try and spray things so that ash can also develop some organics in it, some humus in it, so that you can plant some vegetation. So initially they plant some kind of grass on it, and then some humus forms there, and after that some kinds of plants and trees are formed. So they've made a nice park there, so you can have amusement on the ash mound. So that's the thing that we are doing there. But what we are actually dealing with is a huge amount of ash. Okay, so 800 megawatts of power would basically mean in about 30 years of time creating a mountain of about 55 meters tall of fly ash. Okay, so that's the difference. But because of the lower calorific value, the temperature of combustion of the coal is not very high, and so the nitrogen oxide formation is not a major problem here. So we don't have treatment for nitric oxide in our power plants in India. NOx is within the emission norms, so we don't use any NOx treatment. Similarly, Indian coals also very low in sulfur. The sulfur content of Indian coals is about 1/10 of what the coal in the rest of the world would contain. So we also don't need to treat for sulfur dioxide. We can just let the flue gases go. So all we need to do is the flue gases, we need to use very large sized electrostatic precipitators where you put DC voltage of about 50 kilovolts or something of that kind between wires and plates, and the corona discharge that happens from that wire charges the particles, which then migrate towards the plates and get stuck there. So you keep wrapping the plates, collecting the ash and transporting it to the ash mound. This is typically what you do. And the electrostatic precipitators are known to remove about 99.9% of the ash, but still 0.01% of the ash goes out, and that's quite a lot of ash. Right, 0.01% is not small. It is actually 1 in 10,000 of the quantity of ash that is produced. If we can produce a 55 meter tall mountain in 30 years, 1/10,000th of that is also inhaled by you or by the people that are around. Okay, and that's not a small quantity. A mountain of 55 meters height and IIT's area, and take 1/10,000th of that, that's quite a lot to inhale. right? Still that much of ash is being thrown out by the thing. 99.99 is a very good number, and 0.01 is a very small number, but not in terms of the quantity that is there. So this is the basic summary of the power plant. So when we go to the power plant, what we will see would be the main circuit. So you have the pump, you have the boiler, you have the turbine, and connected to the generator, and then you have the condenser. Right, so this is your main circuit. The boiler would have fuel system and flue gas and air, okay, and the condenser would have cooling towers, to supply the water to and back, okay. And from the boiler you also have ash going out, okay. So this is primarily what you will see, but also in the cycle, it's not just pump, boiler, turbine and condenser, you also have several heat recovery systems, right. So the hot gases that are leaving the boiler are used to preheat the water that is coming here, and also preheat the air that is supplied to the boiler, okay. So you'll have what is called the air preheater and the economizer. Economizer is where you take the heat from the flue gases and preheat water, and air preheater is where you take the energy, waste energy going in the flue gases to preheat combustion air, okay. So that the amount of energy that is thrown out is bare minimum. Usually the flue gas that goes out is at of the order of 120 degrees Celsius to 140 degrees Celsius temperature, while the combustion actually happens at about 1700 degrees Celsius. So substantial amount of energy is absorbed in the whole process, and you are only allowing the flue gases to leave at this temperature. This temperature is critical because if you make it lower, then whatever little sulfur that's there in the flue gases in the form of sulfur dioxide, along with the water vapor that is there in the flue gases, together start condensing as sulfurous and sulfuric acid on the surfaces of your heat exchanger. Okay, if you reduce the temperature of the flue gases below what is called the acid dew point. All of us understand dew point, right? Dew point is the temperature at which the moisture starts condensing, okay? So dew point temperatures would be much lower for the moisture to start condensing, but because you have sulfuric acid, the sulfuric acid dew points are much higher, right? So sulfuric acid would start condensing depending on the concentration of the sulfuric acid in the surroundings, in the flue gases. So if you are dealing with power plants of the kind that you have in the other countries, where the coal itself has about 2-4% ash, 2-4% sulfur, the sulfur dioxide concentration in the flue gases, you cannot cool it below 200 degrees Celsius or 180 degrees Celsius because the acid starts condensing at that temperature. But because our coal has much less sulfur in it, about 0.5-0.6% sulfur or even lower than that, so because of that, the acid dew point is of the order of 110-115 degrees Celsius. So you let the gases go out just above the acid dew point, right? So this temperature. So this is your system. So you absorb heat for air preheating, you absorb heat for preheating the water, both done from the flue gas. So that introduces components like air preheater and economizer. Okay. Besides that, since the expansion of the turbine is also substantial and the exit volume is going to be very large, you try to bleed some part of the steam from the turbine for preheating the water so that you have a regenerative cycle. Okay, so the turbine is not adiabatic anymore. You take energy from the turbine by bleeding steam from there and mix it with the steam or use it to preheat the steam. So the water that is going from the pump to the boiler has several what you call feed water heaters. Okay. Several feed water heaters are there in the path between, in fact, in the path between condenser to the boiler. Okay. There are some feed water heaters here. The pump itself is normally in two parts. You call it the condensate extraction pump, which takes the water from the subatmospheric pressure that it is in the condenser, because you would like the condensation to happen close to room temperature. And at room temperature, the saturation pressure of water is about 1/10 of the atmospheric pressure. So the condenser operates at very low pressure, subatmospheric pressure in vacuum rather. So from that pressure to ambient pressure, you use what is called a condensate extraction pump. Okay. So that pump brings the water close to the atmospheric conditions, and then at that condition, you would have a few feed water heaters, which are called the low pressure feed water heaters. Okay. And after that, you have the boiler feed pump, which takes the water from near atmospheric pressures to the boiler pressure. Okay. And after the water is pumped to that kind of pressure, you have additional feed water heaters here, and then the economizer. Okay. So the water that is extracted from the condenser goes through the condensate extraction pump, the LP heaters, the low pressure heaters, the boiler feed pump, and the HP heaters. So the total number of feed water heaters is usually about 6 or 7. Okay, in most power plants of the sub critical kind, where the boiler pressure is, the water pressure in the boiler is less than critical pressure. The plant that we are going to see is a subcritical boiler. Okay, so this will be that. So the number of feed water heaters would be typically around 6. Okay, 2 LP heaters and 4 HP heaters, or whatever that number. There will be such division. So all this is basically to ensure that the non-isothermal part of the water heating. So if you look at the TS diagram for the heating process, you have this, this, and this in the boiler. Okay. So that is water from subcooled condition up to saturation, then at saturation, and then superheat. Now, most of this is done outside the boiler by feed water heating and by the economizer. And the water that enters the boiler is very nearly at boiling point. Okay. And boiling point at about 200 atmospheres pressure is close to 320-325 degrees Celsius, right? Because at critical pressure it is 374 degrees Celsius. You are slightly lower than critical pressure. So the boiling point of water at about 200 atmospheres or 190 atmospheres at which the boiler operates would be close to 325 degrees Celsius. Okay. So the water exiting the economizer is usually close to that temperature. There are some designs of economizer where the water boils in the economizer. There are some designs of economizer where the water does not boil in the economizer. Most of our economizers, the water does not boil there. So it is just below the saturation conditions at that pressure. So the water pressure is about 200 bar, and the water temperature that comes out of the economizer will be about 310-315 degrees Celsius. At that it enters. So much of the non-isothermal heat addition is done by heat recovery itself, so that your cycle efficiency goes up, because your cycle efficiency depends on, from thermodynamics, the temperature at which heat is added and the temperature at which heat is removed. So higher the temperature at which heat is added and lower the temperature at which heat is removed, the higher will be your cycle efficiency. Okay. So in order to ensure that, much of your non-isothermal heat addition is done by heat recovery within the cycle. And this isothermal part is the major part of the heat addition. After that, the superheating, there's no other way, you have to do it using the boiler, because that's the highest temperature that's required. So it cannot be done by heat recovery. Right? So these two parts are the heat additions in the boiler. This will be the evaporator. This will be the evaporator. And this will be the superheater. So the boiler has the evaporating part and the superheating part. Okay. So the evaporating part is this one and superheating part is this one. So in a boiler, normally the water comes from the feed water heaters and the economizer. Okay. And the boiler itself is a phenomenal thing. So let me spend a little bit of time on the boiler. So the boiler itself looks something like this. Now here, the rounds that I have shown here are the bottom headers. This is nothing but, this whole structure has a pipe that goes around the bottom. So this whole thing is a rectangular cross section. Rectangular cross section typically of the order of about 15 to 20 meters in each dimension. So 15 meters by 15 meters or 20 meters by 20 meters, much bigger than this classroom, right? So that will be your cross section here. And this height is typically of the order of 60 meters. For your reference, our main building is about 35 meters tall, right? So you're talking about practically double our main building's height in the boiler. And this typically about 50 to 20 meters in dimension. That varies from boiler to boiler, okay? So this pipe that I've shown here runs around the whole bottom of the tall structure into which the water to be heated is supplied. Okay, from the economizer the water comes here. And then along the wall on the inside you have tubes. So all along the walls of the boiler, if you imagine these are the walls of the boiler, you have tubes that are embedded. Okay, so the concrete structure or the steel structure of the wall is not directly exposed to the heat of the boiler. What is exposed to the heat of the boiler is the water tubes. Okay, and this portion constitutes what we call the evaporator section. Okay, the water vaporizes from 300 degrees Celsius where it enters to about 350 degrees Celsius, which is the boiling point typically at those pressures. So the water evaporates in those temperatures in this section of the boiler, and after that it goes to the top. So you basically have these headers and there is a drum which sits on top of this boiler drum. So from the drum you have the downcomers which come from outside and connect to the header, and from this header you have multiple risers which are taking the water upwards. Okay, so all these risers are along the inner walls of the boiler. So what happens when the boiler the water absorbs energy, part of it evaporates and part of it remains liquid. So the density of the water vapor mixture in the risers is going to be lower because it is partly water and partly vapor, and this one is going to be heavier because it's all water. So there is a natural circulation that is established. In the downcomer, the water will come down by gravity, which will push the water in the risers up. And there will be a natural circulation that is set up between the drum and the headers, right? And the circulation, usually you maintain a mass flow rate of circulation about 6 to 7 times the rate of evaporation. So typically about 1/6 to 1/7 of the water evaporates here. So if I have to produce steam, for example, at the rate of 150 kilograms per hour, kilograms per second, then the flow rate through this will be something of the order of 750, 800, 900 kilograms per second. So that's the kind of flow rate that you maintain here. So that the inside tubes that are here, which are directly exposed to the fire, they never run dry. They always have a large quantity of water in them. Only about 1/5 or 1/6 of the tubes would be vapor when they reach the top. Okay, because the water is going from bottom to top, the vapor fraction will be the highest at the top. Okay, by the time it reaches the top, only about 1/7 or 1/6 of the water evaporates. The remaining is still there, so it's still bearing liquid, so that the wall temperatures of the tubes don't go too high, because the gas temperatures here can be of the order of 1600-1700 degrees Celsius, and so the material should still be kept at about 400-500-600 degrees Celsius, beyond which the material will become softer. It's usually made of iron alloys. Okay, alloy tubes of steel cannot typically sustain temperatures higher than 600 degrees Celsius, 650 degrees Celsius. Okay, so that is what you try to maintain in this. So this is your evaporator part of the boiler, and then from the drum itself, if I draw it larger here, will contain liquid here and vapor here. By gravity, there is a density difference between the liquid and vapor. Vf is smaller than Vg, which basically means density of the liquid is higher than density of vapor. That density difference goes on decreasing as I go up in the steam dome in the TS diagram, or if the PV diagram if I draw, the difference between Vf and Vg goes on decreasing as I approach the critical point, right. So in subcritical boilers, you try to keep the pressure about 15-20 bar lower than the critical pressure, so that the drum can work by gravity. Okay, there is enough gravitational head to be able to separate the liquid from the vapor. Otherwise, if the density difference is so small, then you might need to use other mechanisms to separate the liquid and water, liquid and vapor. You need to have other accelerating mechanisms so that you get more than one G to act on the delta rho. Right. So, in order to avoid that, you maintain the drum pressure about 180-190 bar when the critical pressure is 220. Right. So this vapor then from here goes to superheater, and the liquid goes to the downcomers. Right. And the risers bring the liquid vapor mixture back here. Okay. So the drum maintains the stability of operation of the boiler. The level of liquid in the drum is very critical. So you need to keep monitoring that as a control mechanism. Right. So then the superheaters are all here normally. Okay. There are some superheaters which directly see the fire, so they can get energy by radiation. There are some superheaters which are here in the convective region where the flow goes horizontal and then flow turns around here. Okay. So these are tubes that are hanging, bundles of tubes that are hanging. Like it was said in the video, the total length of tubes in a particular boiler can exceed a few kilometers. Okay. Typically the length of tubes making up a boiler of the evaporator region and all the superheaters, economizer, everything put together, can be of the order of about 3-3.5 kilometers length. Right. So that much of tubes is all packed and aligned all over there. So you have the superheaters here. Normally the superheaters also have a counter flow arrangement. That is, if the flue gases are flowing this way, the lowest temperature water would enter here, and then as the temperature goes up, it goes to superheaters that are here, which is basically opposite in direction, so that the higher temperature water is in contact with higher temperature steam, higher temperature gas, and lower temperature water is in contact with the lower temperature gas, so that the temperature difference of heating does not produce a large irreversibility in the heating. Because any heating process, according to second law, would have more irreversibility if the delta T for the heating is larger. So you need to keep the entropy generation minimal, so you always use a counterflow configuration. You keep the lowest temperature of water where the lowest temperature of gases is there, and the highest temperature of water where the highest temperature of gases is there. Still, there is a temperature difference that is maintained, so that there is heating continuously happening. Okay. So you will have low temperature superheater somewhere here, and if there are more than one or two superheaters, there might be an intermediate temperature superheater here and a high temperature superheater here. Okay. And then the boiler also has a reheater. So what happens is that you produce steam, you take it to the HP turbine, high pressure turbine, expand it there, and after the expansion of the high pressure turbine, you bring the steam back to the boiler, reheat it to the original temperature, let us say 540-550 degrees Celsius, at now the lower pressure. Okay, and then take it back to the intermediate and lower pressure turbines. Okay, so that is another process that happens. So let me show that. If let us say this is my boiler and this is my HP turbine, then I have the IP turbine and the LP turbine, high pressure, intermediate pressure and low pressure turbines. So the water from the superheater goes to the HP turbine, and from here the water comes back here, okay, and the reheated water again goes to the IP turbine, and from the IP turbine it goes to the LP turbine and then to the condenser. Okay, so this is your water circuit. So you will have, this is what is called the main steam. Okay, this line is going for the reheat, and so it is called the cold reheat steam, usually called the CRH, the cold reheat steam, which basically is the return steam from the high pressure turbine back to the boiler. This is called the hot reheat. After heating it goes back to the turbine. So from the boiler you will find one pipe coming to the high pressure turbine, then two pipes going from the intermediate pressure turbine. So one is the, or between the HP and IP, the CRH will be there and the HRH will come back to the IP, right. So these two pipes will be substantially bigger as compared to this pipe because the steam has already expanded and its specific volume is now higher, right. So the same mass flow would require a larger pipe to carry the same steam. So the main steam pipe will be smaller and the cold reheat and hot reheat pipes will be much larger in size. So by looking at these names or the labels in the power plant, you should be able to figure out, this is the hot reheat pipe and this is a cold reheat pipe. And by their size also you can figure them out. The main steam pipe will be much smaller as compared to the CRH and HRH pipes. And from the IP, the steam goes to the LP, and from this LP it goes to the condenser. So that's your steam path. So here in the boiler itself, many of these surfaces, you'll have the low temperature superheater, intermediate temperature superheater, high temperature superheater, low temperature reheater, intermediate temperature reheater, high temperature reheater. So you have multiple heat exchangers arranged one after the other there. Okay, so this is the whole thing. Anyway, any of these we will not be able to see from inside, right, because the boiler would be operational. We might find small peepholes somewhere at this elevation through which you can just get a feel for what happens inside the boiler. It will be a small peephole through which you can look it. Fortunately for you, the boilers are usually at pressure slightly lower than the atmospheric pressure. So if you open the peephole, the fire doesn't come out, but outside air goes in. So you can look from there. Otherwise, the peepholes will be of dangerous consequence. Normally what you try to do is to maintain the boiler at a pressure which is slightly lower than atmospheric, which is the next thing that I'm going to discuss. When we talked about the air supply, okay, we talked about this air supply. Yeah. Yes, it keeps circulating between the drum and the header and back to the drum.
So the whole system has just 1/7 of that component recirculating.
The entire water recirculates such that 1/7 of it evaporates at any given time.
What is the mass flow rate in the whole system? What is the mass flow rate that actually gets out of the boiler? Is it 1/7?
It's 1/7. So you will have a recirculating system here, where is that? Yeah, this one, which will have a flow rate about 7 times the flow rate that goes out here. Okay, so this M dot, or let us say M1 dot, and this is M2 dot. Okay, M1 dot goes in and comes back. This M1 dot would be about 6 to 7 times M2 dot. Okay, so this is your steam throughput that goes to your turbine. Okay, and that steam again finally going through the whole cycle, and after the economizer, it will come back to the same drum. Okay, it will go from here to the high pressure turbine, back to reheaters, intermediate pressure turbine and low pressure turbine, condenser, and the whole process of pumping and feed water heaters and economizer back to the drum. Okay, so this takes a long route and these take a shorter circle. Okay, so that's the way. Now the air supply system that we talked about normally is done by two different blowers, or we would call them fans, okay, because their pressure rise is not as high as it should to be to qualify it as a blower. We'll talk about them later. So you have what is called a primary air fan and forced draft fan. Okay, so if this is my boiler, I'll have atmospheric air taken into what is called the primary air fan and FD fan, which is the forced draft fan. Okay, now this air goes through your pulverizer and brings coal into the boiler. This air goes directly to the boiler. Both of them actually go through what is called the air preheater. So you have atmospheric air taken in by the PA fan and the FD fan. It goes through the air preheater, and then after that the primary air goes to the pulverizer, picks up the coal which is powdered and takes it to the boiler, and the secondary air fan directly goes to the boiler, and here there is combustion happening. Okay, and there is what is called the induced draft fan, or called the ID fan, which connects it to the stack. Okay, and in between this you have the ash removal system, which is the ESP, the electrostatic precipitator, that is here. So the induced draft fan produces suction that reduces the pressure here, and the forced draft and primary air fan produce pushing which increases the pressure here. The balance between these two is maintained in such a way that this pressure is slightly below the atmospheric pressure. So this kind of a system is called a balanced draft. Okay, it's the balance between, delicate balance between the ID fan and the FD and PA fans that maintains the boiler pressure at slightly subatmospheric values, which is a safety requirement. And in order to make sure that this safety is always ensured, the ID fan and the FD fan usually have 100% redundancy. Okay, you have two ID fans and two FD fans, right? Both of them operating at about half of their capacity if necessary, or one of them operational, the other on standby. Okay, so if there is any failure for any reason of one of the fans, the other fan immediately comes on within seconds, so that there is no disturbance of the whole draft in the system. Okay, if that disturbance actually happens, then there can be a major accident in a power plant because of the kind of flow rates of coal that keep getting burned inside the power plant. Okay, it's typically in the order of hundreds of kg per hour. The coal is being burned at that very high flow rate. So you normally ensure that the FD and ID fans have practically 100% redundancy in a given power plant. Okay, so that is the draft part. So what have we not talked about? The electrostatic precipitator I have told you about, the air preheaters I have told you about. The last thing that we have not talked about is the cooling tower. Okay, the fuel we have already talked about. Basically the coal arrives by trains into coal yards where you have large machinery which take the coal from there and stack them up into huge piles the way they showed here. And from the piles, the coal is taken through conveyor belts into large bunkers. In the way, the coal is crushed into smaller pieces, because the coal that arrives from the mines can be of sizes from the size of a powder to the size of this big slabs. Right? So you take it into a crusher, and the crusher basically crushes the coal into smaller pieces, separates pieces like metal, stone, various other things which are other than coal by some mechanism in the crusher itself, classifies it, and then sends only the coal part of it into the bunkers. And the bunkers are very tall, I mean practically as tall or 3/4 of the height of the boiler, and large size. So they can store coal which can be burned for a few hours. Okay, so if you find that your coal line supplying to the bunker has become defunct, you still have a few hours to react. For some reason, some coal has got exhausted, or some machine has failed, or something has failed. The buffer gives you the bunker gives you the buffer stock to keep the boiler running for some time. And from the bunker, you have the pulverizers. The kind of pulverizer that was told about in the video was that you have a drum inside which you have the coal and steel balls rolling along with each other. So the steel balls crush the coal to powder. The kind of pulverizers that we have here are bowl type pulverizers, okay, with stones, grinding stones in them, three grinding stones. So this bowl is rotated. So by friction, the three rollers that are there inside the bowl turn. This mechanism is very similar to the wet grinders that might be used in idli grinding in South India, if you are familiar with that. Basically, it's just a ball rotating by a mechanical force, and there are three rollers that are kept inside that. So the coal is fed to it, and the rotation of the grinding wheels powders it, and the hot primary air comes in there, and then whatever coal powder can float up in that air velocity will be carried by the air. So that automatically classifies the powder size. Okay, you also adjust the classification by putting some vanes in the path of the coal flow, so that those which can pass through the vane and go with the airflow will go out. The rest will fall back into the grinder and keep getting ground further. Right. So this is your pulverizer. That's the mechanism by which pulverizer works. So we'll be basically seeing all of these. We'll normally look at the coal yard. We'll look at the pulverizers. We'll look at the boiler from bottom to top. So you'll be seeing the boiler drum at the top, and you'll also have large drum at the bottom, which normally is one of the feed water heaters, which is an open feed water heater, which actually is used for exhausting dissolved gases. So suppose the water that is going through the turbine has dissolved oxygen in it for some reason, it can become very corrosive. So when the boiler is very close to its boiling point, when the water is very close to its boiling point, the solubility of any of the gases inside it will be very small. So at that point of time, you let the steam out. Along with the steam, it will also carry the dissolved gases, which will go out. So this drum, which is kept at the bottom of the boiler, is called a deaerator. Okay, it removes the air which is dissolved in the water. So it's a deaerator. A similar drum will be there at the top. The boiler drum that I talked about, the diagram that I made here, is the cross section. Usually this drum is about 2 or 3 meters or 4 meters in diameter, and about 20 meters long. It's a long pressure vessel which is there, and the deaerator will be a similar structure at the bottom. Okay, so you'll basically have this as a system. So we normally walk up the boiler from the bottom. You look at the various pulverizers and all that, and then you walk up, you look at the boiler from outside, you look, go and look at the boiler drum at the top, then you come downstairs and you go to the turbine hall. You look at the turbine, then go under the turbine. The floor under the turbine usually has the condenser and also all the feed water heaters. And the floor below that would have all the pumps and motors that are the boiler feed pumps. And so you have multiple floors on which you'll go and look at that. The turbine hall has the same floor as the control room. Okay, so the control room of the whole power plant is on the same floor as the turbine hall. So this is what you typically would see inside the power plant. And then when you go out, you see the generator is coupled to the turbine. When you go out, you see the electric switchyard, and you also see the cooling towers which are connected to the power plant. So this is typically what you see in a power plant, and that in itself would be quite a bit of walking for you guys, right? So let's physically gear up, okay? Do some exercise before you come there. The next thing that I wanted to show you was a combined cycle power plant, which is the second plant that is there in Dadri. Dadri is also on the HBJ gas pipeline, Hazira, Bijaipur, Jagdishpur gas pipeline. So the natural gas pipeline goes in the vicinity of Dadri. So the combined cycle power plant draws natural gas from that pipeline and runs two gas turbines. And the exhaust of the two gas turbines together are very hot, hot enough to be able to boil water and make steam in a boiler. So the exhaust of the two gas turbines runs a boiler which is called the waste heat steam generator system, or heat recovery steam generator, HRSG. Okay. So that is used to make steam which runs a steam turbine. Okay. So the total power output will be 300 plus 300, 600 megawatts in two gas turbines and 210 megawatts in a steam turbine. So total of about 810 megawatts in the combined cycle power plant. In the coal-based power plant, we have four coal-based turbines, steam turbines of 210 megawatts, so to 840 megawatts. So the two units put together supply about 1650 megawatts of electricity from there. And Dadri phase 2 was also under construction. I hope some of the turbines are presently ready. Dadri phase 2 had, I think, two units of 500 megawatt turbines of coal-based. So the entire power generation output has gone up by another 1000 megawatts from the same region. So that's that. So let me just show you a small video about the combined cycle power plants, and then we can discuss about that in close.
Electrical power is generated in two cycles. The first cycle consists of a gas turbine, which burns typically natural gas as the... ...60% plus. This is the electrical efficiency that can be reached by a combined cycle power plant compared to 40% for a simple cycle. It means that 60% of the fuel consumed is transformed into electrical power, thus ranking combined cycle power plants among the most efficient thermal power plants. Let's see how it works. In a combined cycle power plant, electrical power is generated in two cycles. The first cycle consists of a gas turbine, which burns typically natural gas as the primary fuel. The combusted gas expands through the turbine, turning the gas turbine rotor. The gas turbine, in turn, is coupled to and drives an electrical generator, which produces electrical power. After passing through the turbine, the hot gas passes to the gas turbine exhaust. In a simple cycle, the process stops here, and the exhaust gas is wasted, evacuated via an exhaust stack to the atmosphere. In a combined cycle, however, there is a second cycle called a bottoming cycle, where the heat in the exhaust gas of the gas turbine is extracted to raise steam. To do this, the hot gas is fed into a heat recovery steam generator. The steam thus generated is then used to drive a steam turbine. Combined cycle power plants increase the overall efficiency of thermal power generation, enabling significant reduction in exhaust emissions such as CO2 and nitrous oxides. They also provide a reliable and flexible power source to back up fluctuations in renewable energy power generation. A world leader in turnkey electric power plants and its components, Alstom has delivered more than 200 combined cycle power plants worldwide over the last 56 years.
Okay. So, a combined cycle power plant as such is a much cleaner system and a much more compact and a much smaller unit, because it does not have the big coal yard and the big ash dumping ground, right? So those are the biggest parts of a power plant, which are completely removed here. So you only have the power plant, you have the gas supply coming from somewhere, it runs the gas turbine, there are two of them, and the exhaust of the gas turbine goes to a steam generator, the boiler, and from there it runs the steam turbine. So it's a much more compact unit, which produces 800 megawatts, but it uses much more expensive fuel. Right, coal is a much cheaper fuel, it is a much more expensive fuel, okay. And Dadri is able to use it because of the vicinity of the HBJ pipeline, which is not too far away from Dadri, so you just draw from there to use that. Other than that, the subsystems of a combined cycle power plant are much simpler. You have the gas turbine has a compressor, a combustion chamber and turbine, the usual set. So there are two such gas turbines, and the exhaust of the gas turbines goes to the steam generator, which has similar units as in the steam generator unit here. And the steam turbine now normally operates at a much lower pressure as compared to the steam turbine of coal-based power plant, because the gas turbine exhaust is usually available at much lower temperatures as compared to the combustion gases in a coal-based power plant. Okay. Normally you avoid additional or supplementary firing in the heat recovery steam generator. Sometimes that is also done in some power plants. I don't think Dadri has a supplementary firing possibility. So if the gas turbines are working at a lower power and the steam is not coming adequately, you can do additional firing in the heat recovery steam generator to increase the steam production. Okay, so that possibility exists in some of the combined cycle power plants, but I don't think Dadri has that facility. Right? So we'll be seeing these. What I have done is I have uploaded a set of instructions on the course website. I'll send you an email link. Otherwise, you can just go to the course website. There's a set of instructions and there's a set of names of people who will be going on 5th, people who will be going on 12th. Okay. The very important instruction is that all of you should be in well-fitting clothes, no loose clothes, no kurta, no loose clothes, and people who have long hair, kindly tie them up in such a way that, you know, it's not a a safety hazard for you guys, right? And all of you in shoes, right? Sports shoes are okay, no formal shoes are necessary, but all of you should be in shoes, no chappals, no sandals, okay, nothing loose like that. Go in a way that you would normally go to a factory or a shop floor, right? It's for your own safety. And we'll have to leave around 7:45 in the morning. We have about 2.5 hours drive, okay, because Dadri is quite far off. I'm going to call the buses at 7:30. What they have told us is to reach there by 10 o'clock. Okay, 7:45 is already late for that. But I thought calling you earlier than that is going to also be difficult, right? So we'll start around 7:45 here, so please report to the bus definitely before 7:45. Okay, so when at 7:45 the bus will move. So you will have to be there between 7:30 and 7:45, reach the bus. We'll call the bus near Karakoram Hostel. Okay. We'll move from there. We'll have to go from this side of the campus because we have to go to Dadri, which is on the National Highway towards Ghaziabad and that side. So we have to go via the main academic area. So if there are girls in the group, Sanju is the only one here. So if you are in whichever group, you can wait near the roundabout, main roundabout here. So you can be picked up from there and be in phone touch with your friends so that you not miss the bus. And we will have lunch there. Okay, there is a canteen with subsidized lunch available there, and lunch has been arranged on payment basis. You might need to shell out something like 20-30 rupees for your lunch, right? And that's what I have arranged. There's no other option. Dadri doesn't have fancy restaurants for you guys to go and have fun. You might have something in their canteen, but that's at most what you would have. So I've arranged for lunch right there. And post lunch, we will see the other power plants. So we'll be seeing two power plants. We'll plan to leave from there around 4:30 or so, reaching here around 6:30. So it'll be a long day, 7:30 in the morning to about 6:30 in the evening. Be prepared for it. I have given all the instructions in the note that I have put up. Please follow it, and all of you be there on time, right? And be there in clothes that are permitted. Don't come there in chappals, I'll send you back, right? And no shorts, okay? Be in informal clothes is okay. Informal clothes is okay, but covering all parts of your body for your own safety, right? And be prepared to climb the 60-meter boiler and back down, and then walk to the ash mound and climb up 55 meters there. Right? Be prepared for its stamina. Any questions? Anything that you wanted to ask? Okay, so then the group of fifth, I will, most likely Amit Gupta will go with the group on fifth, and I will be going with the group on 12th. Right, so that's the way it will go. So those of you who are going on 5th, please report there by 7:30, 7:35. So we can take your attendance, and then the bus can move at 7:45.